Hello and welcome to this week's Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podcasting with me today are Alan Temple.
Hello.
Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
And George Cran, who is actually here, but after the disastrous events at Palmerston last weekend, we've bound and gagged them, so he can't speak. Now, he's actually got tonsillitis.
Genuinely has lost his voice for all the celebrating.
Yes, he's lost his voice, so there's no point in him turning up, which is what we say most weeks. But this week, there's a good reason for that. And seeing as George is not here, we'll speak about that disaster at Palmerston, Alan. You were there. Read your report.
Someone did.
Not the worst, but many did. Not the worst performance, but careless, was it?
Yeah, I suppose you could put it that way. A little bit of carelessness and wastefulness and a little bit of young Harry Stone having the absolute performance of his life. It was an extraordinary goalkeeping display from a young man who there actually has been quite a bit of hype about from, you know, when I was on the Edinburgh beat, a young keeper coming through, idolising Craig Gordon, very much the same sort of build, all limbs, that kind of a goalkeeper. And, well, you wouldn't say he's got the same shot-stopping ability. The amount of shots he did stop on Saturday was staggering. The BBC stats put it at 35 shots from United and 18 on target. People at United actually think it's a bit more, obviously without them giving me their Y-Scout login. I can't verify that, but it's it was a very frustrating afternoon for those of a United persuasion, I would say. And what I'm reluctant to do is to write that off and say, well, they played brilliantly, just didn't take their chances, because that's a stupid thing to say, because taking your chances is a pretty big part of this sport. So that is a criticism, and they should have done better in front of
us. Paraphrase Kylian Mbappe on Tuesday night after the Newcastle game. He just honestly said, we shouldn't have that many chances and not score with our quality. And that applies to United at their level, doesn't
it? 100%. They should have made more of their chances, of their territory, and they should have defended better at the other end. That's a couple of games now against League One opposition where they've been a little bit, I wouldn't say wobbly, because they were solid for the majority of the game, but in terms of the goals they conceded, wobbly at the back. So things to work on, but what I would say is, and you know, you'll get a natural reaction from fans that are humiliated and embarrassed and don't like the fact they've been put out of the Scottish Cup, such a big deal. By a League One team. But what I would say is, I think anyone who was at that game will acknowledge that it was an aberration, in terms of those who weren't at the game might have a slightly different perception of it, but it was one of the stranger games I've been at, just in terms of the sheer flow of chances. And there comes a point, and we've probably all been at games like this, when you kind of think, we're kind of living in this young goalkeeper's narrative today. Like, he is destined to be the hero this afternoon. And when he made an unbelievable low reflex stop in the 117th minute from Chris Mockery, it's, you know, Mockery, no backlift, got a really sharp shot away, the kind of shot that usually surprises a goalkeeper. Stone somehow gets his frame down to that and parries it away. And at that point, you're just thinking, this is just this kid's day. You know, it's... and you don't want to be a slave to fate or anything, but you did feel like a horrible cliche, but it was one of those days for United. But as I say, that's not to make excuses. They should have been more clinical, should have defended better. That's two defeats in a row, not great. But it wasn't a disastrous performance. It really wasn't.
Yeah, and Bear, without pretending it's the crisis of all crisis, because but it is Dundee United. They shouldn't lose to a struggling League One team. And they have put pressure on themselves. I mean, they've lost as many goals in the last two cup ties as they have in the league all season. Mm-hmm. And it does put unnecessary pressure on themselves now going into what is... I mean, I've looked, they've got Morton away this weekend, Ayr at home, and then Raith at home. Now, unlike managers, we don't need to take it one game at a time. But I would say if you take 9 points from those games... you can, as long as your attitude's right, you can basically cruise the rest of the season, because you know the gap. I mean that in the best sense of the word, and that you just focus on, right, let's keep doing what we're doing. and you don't have to look at anyone else, because the gap would be bigger by definition, because the third of those games is Raith at home. And you could put yourselves in a hugely commanding position, but you wanted to go into that period in the league on the back of two cup wins, and instead it's the back of two cup defeats.
Yeah, I mean, 9 points from those games. I mean, Dundee United fans and manager Jim Goodwin would bite your arm off for that at this point. Your arm and half your body, I would imagine. Unnecessary pressure, but you know, it's probably they've not seen that pressure since early doors in the season. Tom, going way back to the League Cup section when they had a poor start to that, and you know, it's. I warned last week about the Scottish Cup. I know that Queens had been struggling.
I said United by two minimum.
No, I always think when you're going down, especially to play on plastic, it's a tricky place to go. But the biggest thing for me was Dundee United had to win the game. Mm-hmm. The Scottish Cup, I warned about penalty kicks, the scenario of penalty kicks. I think it gives lesser teams a slight advantage, and as much as they can have a day like Queens obviously had, the keeper has an absolute stormer. It goes to penalties, and it's anyone's game from that point on. So
on that subject, I haven't looked at the stats, but my feeling about it since they started saying this is a one-game competition, more games are going to penalties, and there's definitely pressure on the bigger team, isn't there?
There is, but you know that from the outset, you've got to go and win the game. Mm-hmm. A draw, and it's anybody's game. That's what I would say to these teams, and... Yeah, fair play to Queens for putting in a performance they did. And I never actually saw the game. The keepers had an absolute stormer by all accounts. And we've seen that scenario play out before, Tom. But looking at Dundee United, that's six goals, I think, in two games that they've shipped. And that's not been like them at all this season. And that's something that they need to get sorted quickly because, okay, defeat to Falkirk, you know, as a slight concern. They then lose in the Scottish Cup, which is a massive competition for Dundee United and their fans. And although the vast majority of their fans wouldn't have been at Palmerston, you know, but it's still a sore one for them to take. It becomes a bit of a crisis. If they go down to Greenock on Saturday, which is a tough, it's not the game I would have picked to try and bounce back from at Cappielow. Morton have been struggling this season, but Greenock is notoriously tough to go and get a result. But
I must admit, I didn't look at Saturday's fixture until this morning because I was a bit fed up with United after last Saturday, and I went,
It's not one you would... I mean, the pitch is normally okay, but the environment, it's always a tough place. You know, it's always a tough place to go and get a result. But if they don't get a victory and the slight of defeat, it does become a crisis. We are in crisis terms. That's where we're at this point in time. We're not there yet, but they're moving towards that, and that's something that Jim Goodwin will be totally aware of. And you know, he'll been working hard this week to get his team back to where they were before the Falkirk game, and get their minds back on the defensive solidity, which has given them a platform to go and pick up so many points this season. But as you say, you know, you just mentioned three games. If they can get 9 points from that, I'm not sure if they would cruise in from there because Raith...
I'm sticking with the one by October, so I'm going to go for the 9 points.
Raith Rovers are making a fair fist of it, but they just need to get back on it, Tom, this week and show that those two cup ties were just a blip.
The thing that Bear mentions there that I think is spot on is the defensive solidity to get back to. I know we're talking about missed chances, so obviously that's something they'll look to fix, but... From a simplistic point of view, just the back to basics stuff. Don't concede silly goals, because that is the one thing that Morton will test them on. Morton's corner kick routines, their physicality. I watched their game recently against Dunfermline that they lost 2-1, and the last half an hour was just bombardment. Mm-hmm. And they put
Seen a game at Cappielow where the ball isn't in the away team's box.
They put deliveries right on top of the goalkeeper, get bodies around, and big boys attacking for everything. And United need to be conscious of that, need to defend well, don't give away sloppy corner kicks, don't give away sloppy fouls around the box to give Morton encouragement. And if they do that basic element of the game right, they will win it, because I think, I mean, even on a day when they missed a hatful of chances, they still scored two goals on Saturday. Mm-hmm. Dundee United will score goals over the course of a 90-minute game because of the quality they have on their side. They just need to cut out the wee defensive errors that have slipped in the last couple of games. And I don't think that's something that's difficult to address, to be perfectly honest, because you would just point at you know, the whatever 19 games prior to the most recent two and say, you know, you have done it this season. So just get, you know, get back to that and put a wee bit of renewed focus on that, because we know how strong Dundee United can be defensively.
And it's a plus. I mean, everybody has bad games. Nobody's perfect. But the plus, a big help for Jim Goodwin, he's got guys like Declan Gallagher and Kevin Holt who can work out for themselves what they've been doing wrong. And
yeah.
Well, Gallagher last Saturday, if he did do anything wrong, and Holt the lap played both the cup ties. It helps when you've got experienced players, because experienced players can tend to calm themselves down a bit quicker and work out how to get back to doing what they're good at.
Yeah, I've also mentioned in previous episodes that Dundee United have got a team full of, you know, pretty bad losers, so and people with the right character and a real determination, and I'd imagine their pride will probably be hurting a wee bit.
Imagine it's a grumpy place.
Exactly.
In this week,
yeah, I think they're, and that can go one of two ways. You can get some dressing rooms might sulk about that and morale might take a blow. I don't think that's the sort of dressing room Dundee United have at all at the moment. I think there'll be a frustration, an anger, and as I say, there'll be some determination to put that right. So see, you know, it's good. See, if you are wound up about losing a game, the right way to channel that is to be determined to put it right in your next game and not make the same mistakes again, and make sure you respond properly. And I'm pretty confident that Dundee United have got a dressing room that can produce that sort of response, because you can't let it become a malaise, as Bear says. You know, when you're a club the size of Dundee United playing your football in the Championship, things can spiral quite quickly in terms of the perception from your own fan base and even from the outside. So you don't want to let a blip become a kind of momentum loser.
Is another thing about it, is it helped by the fact that Jim Goodwin rebuilt his squad largely over the summer? Because this is maybe a bigger crisis for people like us and the United fans, because we're sitting here going, what happened last season? A couple of bad results and then the whole season fell away. But these over half that squad are not tainted by that brush, because it didn't happen to them.
Yeah, there is that. There's a lot to be said for that. But fans tend to think the worst, hope for the best, you know, but worry about what might go wrong. You know, are we going away to suddenly collapse and allow Raith Rovers to take command of this title race? I just don't see it happening, damn it. I mean, we've spoken about a couple of guys, but you know, United are littered with experience through that team, and you're right, a lot of them are new players. They're not carrying that weight from last season, but you always carry the weight of expectation at Tangerine, which United are going to have to carry this season, because they are the biggest club in the Championship. They're expected to get to the title. They're in number one position at the moment. They've swept all before them, but they've just had a wee hiccup. And you know, that's what happens in football. And I think what Jim Goodwin, they'll have been working this week on the goals they've lost. There's no doubt about that. They'll work defensively on what has gone wrong and try to put certain things right. But he just has to... He'd be speaking to his players and reminding them how well they've done this season, Alan, in league games, and you know, how solid they have been. And look at the positives. You know, there are still positives to take from the game at Queen's. So Kai Fotheringham, another two goals. This guy is emerging as a real star for Dundee United.
Yeah, he was brilliant.
Yeah, he's emerging. Well, you saw I've just seen the goals, which is what, you know, a lot of people will just see. Another couple of goals from this young man. And he has emerged as a real star, a real key player for them. And it looks as if, when Louis Moult isn't banging them in, or Tony Watt, or maybe some of the other players, Chris Mockery, Kai Fotheringham is one you can turn and you can rely on now to get your goals at this level. And I mean, it's just a case of creating chances and opportunities for him. And you expect Dundee United to do that. Even though they're away at a tough place like Morton, you expect Dundee United to create chances, and this young man can get them goals. And I think it is a case, ideally, you know, you want to get in front at Cappielow. That's going to be the secret on Saturday. You don't want to give yourself a bigger
headache by going
behind.
I'm looking at the table here. I was going to say, you get in front at Cappielow. We're talking about the pressure on United, the expectation, the fact of two bad results. They're top of the league. But Morton got a goal behind on Saturday. They're thinking, we could be 5-6 points adrift at the bottom by the end of the day. And Morton would have been tipped as a playoff team at the start of the season. There's pressure on the manager because of that. There's pressure on the players. So you can never forget, there's whenever there's a football game played in front of people and it's competitive, there's pressure on both teams.
Yeah, there will be pressure on Dougie Emery. I don't think he's got a great deal of wiggle room just at the moment. No. In terms of, I'm sure the board at Cappielow will be looking at the response that Inverness have got from Duncan Ferguson. They'll be looking at a Broth about to appoint their new manager and think that could be a new manager bounce. And yeah, there will be.
But incidentally, I think it's a shame because he's got the makings of a right good manager.
I think Dougie Emery's done a fantastic job. I think Morton would already be a League One team if not for Dougie Emery, and the resources aren't exactly abundant at Cappielow these days. But nevertheless, it's such as football that should this carry on much longer, the board will say, what is the one thing we can do? And that ultimately always at any club is change the manager, whether it should be the case or not. So yeah, there will be a lot of pressure on Morton, and to if United can get a couple of early goals, then you'd imagine that stadium could become a fairly unpleasant place to be for the home side. So that'll be something they're looking to do. And I know it's been coloured by the last couple of games, but United on their travels in the Championship this season have been fabulous. Yeah. Largely they've shown an ability to get ahead and turn the screw during several away games this season, and that will certainly be something they're looking to do again. But to circle back on what Bear said about Kai Fotheringham, quite aside from his two goals, it's incredible when you see what confidence does for a young player. And we're maybe seeing the same to an extent with Luke McCowan at Dundee, and it's every time he picked up the ball, it was drive forward and take a man on. There was no second thoughts about it at all. It was, what can I do to get past my man or to cut them open or to have a shot? Everything was so positive, so confident, and that's just, that's a player that's not only flying for his club, he's obviously been away with the under-21s and really taken a lot from that experience as well. And yeah, that was, as it probably should be against a League One opposition, was probably the best that I've seen Kai in terms of, he was just head and shoulders the best player on the pitch.
I was going to say, I don't want to put too much pressure on a young player, but I don't care that much either. He's one. I go back to the Dunfermline game the other week. Before he scored in that game, almost everything he tried didn't come off. But A, he kept trying. And B, if I'm watching him, if I'm sent there to watch that, you know, future opposition, I'm going back and saying, not much came off for that laddie, but he scored a goal. Mm-hmm. And what didn't come off were the right things he tries. Mm-hmm. So what impresses me about him is, I say, whether it comes off or not, you're not critical of what he's trying to do. He's a very intelligent player in the final third, isn't he?
Yeah, he's got a knack of being in the right place at the right time. It's funny because you look at him as a winger, and he isn't the fastest winger you've ever seen in your life. And also, he's not cutting about doing stepovers and Zidane twirls and the kind of magical moments you'd expect from a winger. But he's a very outcome-orientated winger, if that makes sense. You know,
yeah,
he gets the ball out of his feet, he drives, he whips in deliveries, he has shots on goals, which I think is what you want as a striker. You know a ball's coming into the box quick, and it's what you want as a manager, because you know he's going to be finding pockets. And it's not a direct comparison, so for the love of God, don't use it as the headline. But to make a ludicrous comparison, see, like Thomas Muller as a footballer, right? People would say, you can't really pinpoint what he's great at.
Yeah.
However, he's always there. Like, he's made a career out of just popping up in the right spaces.
His great strength is the outcome.
Yeah. And there's...
You've set the bar high there, Alan.
He's just the first, but I can't really think of many other more high.
I know what you're saying. I know exactly what you're saying.
Yeah. He would be the elite example of a player that does that. And Kai Fotheringham, in a Championship football Dundee United context, is kind of doing the same thing. He pops up and you think, Christ, where did he come from? You know, but he's just drifted in and found the right spot. And that could be a form thing. You know, see, when it's happening, it's happening. Yeah. We've all seen hot streaks. So,
well, his goal at Dunfermline the other week, he's never picked up. He's travelled the furthest of any player into the box.
Yeah.
And he's not picked up. And that's a great knack. If wide players couldn't do that, previous days at United, Noel Hunt had that. Noel Hunt wasn't the most naturally gifted player, but he'd wander in from when the ball was on the opposite side of the park. And United scored so many goals either directly from him or from touches by him at the back post.
That gives defenders a problem, players coming from wide areas, because who's actually marking this guy, you know? Yeah. And he's obviously got an eye for a goal as well, which is terrific. I think he's on cloud nine at the moment. Yes. What's happened this season, you can see that. But I also think now I think he feels he's part of this team. I think he feels he's an integral part of this team as well. He deserves to be there. He's there on merit. He's producing every single week. I think the fans are now looking to him to get goals in, and that brings its own pressure with it. Like you say, you don't want to pin too much on his shoulders, but I think he's taking it all in its stride. And
it was outrageous for Alan to compare him with Thomas Muller. But let's be honest about it. He's a player that's playing on the right that comes in and scores lots of goals. He's United's Mo Salah. Enjoy that one, son.
As I say, there's always, we've all seen players that are on a hot streak and things tend to fall for you. The key is consistency. That's what separates a young player who's having a good 2 months with Dundee United, but a player that can potentially cement himself in the starting 11, hopefully as a Premiership team, and then potentially move down south or the likes. That's the difference. So hopefully he carries on, and I get the feeling he probably will, because from speaking to Kai quite a bit, he's a lot of humility there. A lot of humility and hard work underpins the form that he's got, and I think that will take you a long way in this game.
And he's got a wee bit about him, as we saw again, going back to that Dunfermline game. He was getting a lot of stick, and he let them know.
Yeah.
Which is not something that I condone automatically, but when you're getting stick, if fans are giving you stick, as long as it's not overboard, you're allowed to let them know when you do something good.
Yeah, and he's doing the best thing ever, to answer them back by sticking the ball in the opposition net more often than not. I mean, I always feel it's payback time, and a player's been getting a lot of abuse from opposition supporters. If he manages to score, I think he's entitled to go and turn them and maybe say, well, there you go, then have that sort of thing in the kindest possible way. But yeah, he has been the star for Dundee United this season. He's been pretty consistent, I've got to say, in his level of performance. Maybe when a few others have dropped off a wee bit, but Kai Fotheringham is well part of this United team now going forward. There's no doubt about that.
And at the same time, we hope that his form continues. Jim Gooden will be looking for a bit of leadership from his experienced men, which in the league certainly hasn't been lacking this season.
Shouldn't be an issue. Tom, the guys he's got, we spoke about Holt and Gallagher at the back, the goalkeeper's experience. He's got Sybald and Docherty in front of him. They've got Tony Watt's obviously got it. Has he got a problem at this point in time?
Yeah, he's got a slight groin niggle. He was due to see a specialist this week, but I think the prognosis they're expecting from the specialist is, he should be fine to resume at some point next week. So, and they've got people that can come into that position.
They've got a right good balance of experience and youth in there. And even the guys that you would regard as, maybe not so experienced, they've all had good game time this season, Tom. And it's really just a case of getting United, to get them going again, they need a victory. They need a victory at Cappielow and all will be well.
Yeah.
But to get a victory at Cappielow, they have to work for it. There's no doubt about that. So, I think the game probably can't come quick enough for Jim Goodwin and his team. They'll be looking to set the record straight. I've got to say, Morton had a good win on Saturday. I know it was the Scottish Cup. I think it was against Bowness or something like that. I know it was a good cup tie for them to have because it gave them a comfortable win. They got a few goals. I think it was 4-0. I think that Muirhead, who I'm a big fan of, and George Oakley, who I'm also a fan of, I think they can give defenders a handful. They were on the score sheet in that game, but they haven't done it enough this season for me, Morton, and I expect Dundee United to, with ability and the experience in their team, to go down there and get a result on Saturday.
And without wishing to put any more pressure on United, I think we've seen enough from Raith in recent weeks that even if their limited squad in terms of numbers costs them in the end, they're not going anywhere for a while, are they?
No, they're Scottish Cup exploits. We know we've talked about Dundee United long enough, but that 3-0 win over Dunfermline was fantastic. And it showed not only the quality they had on their side, but it showed a real brightness and versatility from the manager.
Yeah.
Changing shape when required. The players took to their new duties brilliantly, and they're a team that's flying at the moment. Confidence is floating. They've got a bit of a swagger about them as a club in general at the moment. Their social media output and things like that is quite sort of combative and good and humorous. Having pops at kind of other clubs and things, and I'm sure they'll all be keeping the receipts for that. It should all go the wrong way for Raith Rover. Yeah. But at the same time, it's
good fun.
Yeah, it is. It's indicative of a club that is in a good place at the moment. It's confident. It's, as I say, it's got a swagger about it. So they are a dangerous foe. And the one thing that you don't want is to take Raith Rovers' glimmer of hope and make that more by your own failings. You don't want to leave the door open for Raith Rovers to be able to say, let's build even more momentum, because they're wobbling. You know, that's what you want to avoid. These two cup games have had absolutely no bearing on who's going to get to the championship. Mm-hmm. The Premiership next season. That's what needs to be remembered. No bearing whatsoever. So United need to get back to it and not give a very, very dangerous Raith Rovers side any more encouragement than they've had already, because there's something special happening at Starks Park this season.
Yeah. Funnily enough, you could see a situation where Ian Murray at Raith, Jim Goodwin at United this weekend, Ian Murray possibly will be the one that mentions the cup exploits more from the point of view of, doesn't mean anything today, because this is what we're...
Yeah, absolutely.
This is the big thing. I'm sure he'll remind these players that the cup is great, but it's a bonus. Mm. They've got themselves in a great position in the league, and they have to keep that going.
Yeah, and they're still... The big thing from Dundee United's perspective, though, is Raith Rovers are chasing. Raith Rovers are always chasing, and Dundee United have got to remember that the pressure is on Raith Rovers to keep up with Dundee United at this point in time. Although I agree with Alan, and I watched the game against Dunfermline, they were fantastic. You know, they're a slick side. They move the ball well. They move around well. They rotate their positions within the team, and they're a really, really good side. But I still think Dundee United are a better side to when you see it. So Dundee United have just got to hold their nerve on Saturday and keep putting pressure on Raith Rovers. As I say, I think the squad size could come back to bite Raith. I felt last season, going back to Dundee, the thing that got Dundee over the line last season ultimately was the size of squad they had. Mm-hmm. And they had a massive squad at Dens Park. I look at Raith, I think they've maybe got, you know, four or five subs on the bench. And then you go beyond that and you really are, you're struggling to sort of...
Yeah, I think last Friday night, if Raith used all their subs, it would involve changing the goalkeeper.
The problem you've got is you're struggling to replace quality with a similar sort of quality. And in the end, that could be what tells for Dundee United. But fair play to Raith. They've made a good job of keeping this championship title race alive this season, because without them, it would honestly by now be a one-horse race.
Which some of us say it is.
Which you keep saying all along, I've got to say.
I must admit...
And you keep bringing it up as well, I've got to say.
I'm not saying I'm unconcerned by the last two games, but I've still got this quiet calmness that I don't associate with myself when it comes to the Dundee clubs, that I just think United... And I'll say this, a lot of games that United have won, and even have won by a few goals... I've looked at them and thought, you could do more with the ball. Mm. You could have done more in this game in possession. But until those last two games, and I'm dismissing them, I'm sticking with their league form. Without the ball, I just think they're such a strong team. Mm. And when they'll come, I tend to think, and I'm not dismissing Raith at all, because I think they've been excellent, but they need to play at that level to get results the way they play. United can have a quiet game in possession, like they did down at Dunfermline, and still win, and you think, well, you deserve to win, and you were quite comfortable because of their work. So if they get back to that organisation and determination off the ball, I'm still very confident about United.
Yeah, I'd be inclined to agree with most of what you've said there, but I would say that game at...
But your job's on the line, so it's worse for you.
That game at...
Not quite on the line.
Oh, did I not, you know that?
Did I not tell you? I've got an envelope here.
I'm looking at that Raith Rovers game at Tannadice, and it is... what I would say is, I don't think you want Raith Rovers within one win of Dundee United when they come to Tannadice.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
It would be a pressure-free environment for them, and I think Tannadice would be quite a nervous place. So... In the long run, I think Dundee United will win the league. I think they'll maybe even win it by a wee bit. But in terms of the short term, I just I worry about giving this Rover side too much momentum while...
Totally agree.
While they're on a high. It's a long old season to come, so that's a different question. But I wouldn't be giving them too much encouragement at the moment. I think that's the key priority for United.
I mean, I have to say, if United go into that Raith game 4 points ahead still, mm-hmm. even allowing for the fact that Raith have a game in hand, I then think a draw, even though it's at Tannerice, is a better result for United, because your Raith have to keep playing catch-up. And the longer you play that, the harder it is to cope. And hey, some teams do cope with it, you never know, but... It keeps the pressure on them.